like to introduce Chief Dan Luna, our SEAL Program Manager at the United States Naval Academy. And here's a short video.
The Trident is the only device that signifies you and identifies you as a SEAL operator. Every day I wear my Trident, no matter where I'm at, what I'm doing, whether it's on down to, Chief Daniel Luna was born in Los Angeles, California, October 14, 1977. After high school, he spent 2 years working for the Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department prior to enlisting in January 1999. His initial sea tours were in the Great Lakes, where he conducted boot camp at Quartermaster's A School. Chief Luna began to graduate with Bud's Class 228. Chief Luna was assigned to San Diego, California at SEAL Team 1, where he served 10 years, completing 5 deployments. The deployments included 2 tours to Iraq, 2 tours to Afghanistan, 1 tour to PACOM and various other countries for joint training. In 2010, screened positive for Naval Special Warfare Development Group and continued various training and deployments while at that command. His qualifications include Joint Terminal Air Controller, Reacher, Sniper, EMT, ASOT Level 2, FO Operator, Static Line and Freefall Jump Master, Range Safety Officer, and various other qualifications. His decorations include 2 Bronze Star Medals with Valor, 2 Purple Hearts, the Defense Meritorious Service Medal, the Joint Commendation Medal, 3 Navy Commendation Medals with Valor, and other various unit and service awards. Chief Luna has an Associate's in Oceanography Technology, a Bachelor's degree in Organizational Leadership from the University of Charleston, and is currently enrolled in Georgetown's Master's of Executive Leadership Program. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our keynote speaker, Chief Daniel Luna.
I think it's funny standing up after that video. I was like, looking around like, who is this guy? That should be Simon Sinek's video. So it's funny, as I was coming in, and I like to sit in the back and kind of move around. I got here before everyone else. Just to prepare for this, I heard a young lady talking about how she doesn't do well early. She's like, oh, it's early in the morning, I need my coffee. And I almost didn't give this speech because of the time slot for this. So I was like, you know what? I wrote it. As soon as they told me, they're like, hey, breaking barriers, obstacles are opportunities. I was like, man, that's awesome. Like, I love that. I was like, I know how this is gonna go. And I started to outline it. I was like, no, I can't do it. Like, it's too heavy. It's not the right audience. It's not right for this. It's too early in the morning. They're not gonna wanna hear this. And then I thought about it some more, and I reached out to some close friends of mine. I was like, hey, this is what I'm thinking about doing. What do you think? And they were like, no, that's it. So we're doing this. and I'm excited. It's gonna be different. This is my disclaimer for those of you that don't know me. I actually come with a disclaimer. The midshipmen already know that. I don't like doing anything wrong. And I don't like to be bored. So I know you guys have been sitting and listening to a lot of people, so it's like, hey, if I was in your seat, I don't want to be bored. So you guys are going to go on an adventure with me. You're not just going to sit there and be participants or active observers. Like, we're all going to leave this place. Not physically. But I want to leave this place. And as I was writing this and as I was doing the outline, I was thinking of Charles Dickens. Was it A Christmas Carol? With Ebenezer Scrooge. Do you guys know what I'm talking about? It's a classic. So what happens to Ebenezer Scrooge? Ghosts come in. The first ghost comes in and takes him out. And so that's what, as I was writing this, I was like, man, that's what I want to do with you guys. So that's what I love to do. So before I came in, people were like, hey, good luck. Hey, relax. Hey, you'll do great. All this stuff. I was like, oh, I'm good. You guys are going on the journey, right? So I want you guys to relax, right? Get ready for this journey that we're going to go on. I'm not going to say anything new, but what I am going to do is reiterate things that you already know, because the amount of pressure that has been put on these items, and they have been tested. And I'm going to take you guys on this journey, and it's going to be a tough journey. And we're going to talk about some obstacles. The video, I'm actually really glad that they did that video. They almost did too good of a job. But in that video, it gave you some imagery. I want you guys to remember that imagery as we travel. And one of the stories I'm actually going to share with you, you got to see the guy in the video. And he's no longer with us. And I'm going to talk about that. So even for me to watch that, and I totally forgot that he was in it, so for me to sit here and then just see him in the video and now get ready to talk about him, like, it's going to be heavy. But I'm excited. And I wrote this, I didn't write it for me, right? So as I did this outline, I didn't do this for me. And what made me stick with what I originally wrote was like, hey man, this is Naval Academy Leadership Conference. And these are some strong people that want to learn, that want to grow. So I'm going to share these stories with them. And so I wrote this for you guys. The mids that know me know, like I'll cut open my chest and I'll expose my heart to a point that, you know, sometimes I even think like, hey, it might be too much. It might be too much for these young people. Right? So I'm going to do that for you guys today. So we're going to kick off this journey. And in this journey, this place, Mahan Hall, this awesome place, it's going to turn into our time machine. So we're all going to travel, I'm going to be your guide, we're going to take this place, and we're going to all leave. We're going to leave Annapolis, we're going to leave Maryland, we're even going to leave this country. We're going to go overseas, we're going to cross the Atlantic, we're going to go to Afghanistan. So I'm going to take you there. Now that I've taken you there, I want you to open your eyes. It's night out, moonless night. I've rewound the clock. It's not 2018. I've rewound it. It's 2009. September 2009. You're on patrol. You've been walking already. You're perspiring. You have the weight of your body armor that's been on you. You have your helmet on. You're looking through your night vision, so everything's green. You've been walking through the desert. You've been on patrol, and you're moving to a village. The sand underneath your feet isn't loose. It's hard. So you're walking on this hard pack. It's open desert. Now you're coming up on this village. You're with a large group of guys. You're coming up on this village. the earpiece in your ear is crackling from the different communications going back and forth from the groups. You now hear that, hey, everyone's gonna go ahead and break off in their little elements. So you move off with your team. Your mission is you're gonna go in, you're gonna secure this one compound at night. And then during the day, you'll go ahead and go through and clear the village. There's a high IED and high mind threat in this area. So you only want to do it during the day. You don't want to be moving around this place at night. So the different teams are breaking off. You're with your team trying to find the compound. You find the compound, you're outside, you're getting ready to make entry into the compound to secure it and set up for the rest of the night. Boom! Huge blast. Everyone hears it. It's actually deafening. Even as far away as it is, it's still deafening because of the silence of the night. And because of the darkness, it almost echoes that noise even louder. You look up, and you can see the huge plume of dirt thrown. And you think to yourself, they are all dead. That is the first thought that goes through your mind. Because you know, as your teams broke up, one of the teams went up to the top of that hill to take that high ground. And they were going to provide overwatch for when you and your team went through and cleared during the day. And you look up, and this blast was so big that you think they are all dead. And you're frozen. And you just stand there, staring at this blast as the dirt is still moving and throwing. And almost like that moment in time where your stillness has anything to do with them up there. That if you move, you could potentially affect that up there. And you're frozen. And then nothing, just silence. Just silence. Your earpiece crackles again. You hear the voice of the troop commander, and he says one word, status. Still no movement. Everything else is silent. Nobody's doing anything. You hear that crackle again in your ear. And it's a new voice. And he's out of breath. There's a little bit of panic, not much, just a little bit of panic in the voice. And he says that there is a wounded SEAL, severely wounded SEAL, and he needs immediate CASVAC. He needs to be flown out of there as soon as we can get something there. But this particular mission has taken us really far from base. It was actually something in our planning consideration, how far we were from base in case something happened. The time of flight to get aircraft there to help somebody out was so far that they may not make it if it was serious. You move through with the rest of the security. Finish clearing the compound. Everyone moves into positions. In the back of your mind, you're thinking about, hey, is that it? Or is that the initiation? Are we gonna fight all night? Or are they gonna wait till the morning to fight us? So we set up our security positions, and you're on a wall, sitting down, looking out, and you can see the hill from the compound that you're at. And on that hill, you start seeing a white light, and you see white lights coming up on that hill. which is really out of the ordinary. So we pride ourselves in no light. We want everything dark. So they're shining these white lights up on that hill. And what you didn't know is that mine that seal had stepped on through the dirt and had uncovered a whole minefield that was up there. So now for the rest of the team to move to that wounded seal, they had to low crawl back to them through a minefield. And so they're like, hey, we're going to use our white lights for this. So they use their white lights, making their way through, trying to get to that wounded seal. That wounded seal, his legs were shredded from stepping on this mine. He didn't do anything wrong. They were up there, they were moving to the position. There was a guy clearing a spot, and they were all in line moving. And then it was his turn to drop off into the position to take watch. And as he stepped off to take his position, that's when he stepped on that mine. By God's grace, helicopters were already coming in. There was another half of the team that they were going to land after we had secured the area. So helicopters weren't too far out, which I think probably saved his life. So as those helicopters are coming in, they had to treat him and move him back down the hill and prepare him to get on the helicopter. Tourniquets, multiple tourniquets on his legs, trying to stop the bleeding. He's bleeding out. So once they do initial treatment, they start moving him down the hill. And as you're sitting there, looking out, holding security, looking through your nods, still sweaty from the heat that's outside, looking up at this hill, and you can see the shadows moving up on the hill, starting to come down. It's a pretty steep hill. And then the screaming starts. And it's not a scream that you've heard in any horror movie. Honestly, it's never a scream that I've never heard another human make. And it's not just one. It's the whole time he's been moved down the hill. This sound. And you can tell when there's big movement as they're trying to get him down that hill. And they're on a little bit of a time constraint because those helicopters only have so much fuel. They can only be on the ground for so long. And they need to get him down and out of there to try and save his life. So there's no time to be gentle. And you can tell when there's big movement because that noise that you hear that you don't think a human can make gets louder. And you know that's your teammate. Coming down. So I'm going to hit pause on that right there. Mainly for me. And I just want to talk about this conference. Obstacles are opportunities. And the military, by design, will put a tremendous amount of pressure on their individuals for training, as they should. And sometimes a tremendous amount of pressure is also put on those individuals, not by design. From my 15 years of combat, from being in those positions with a tremendous amount of pressure, there are some things that I have seen get people through those obstacles. And as I thought of this conference, I'm like, man, obstacles are opportunities. And my thought was, man, sometimes you have to survive the obstacle. Like, life is hard. Life's a gift. Life's amazing. There's all these things, but it's also hard. And your story may not look like that story, but there's remnants of it that each one of us have, that as we go through life, like, there's challenges that hit us, and how do we get through? How do we get through those obstacles? So I put something together as I was outlining this. I was like, man, hey, what are the top three things that I've seen, that I've used, that I've seen others use, like, get through really tough times to survive those obstacles and hopefully turn them into an opportunity. So as I put it together, I wanted to put something together that you guys can remember. And so it's the four F's. I figured that'd be easy for you guys to remember. And the first F I want to talk about is faith. Is faith. People have been killing people for a long time. Soldiers, warriors have been using faith to help them get through hardship for a long time. I'm not going to get into any specifics as I share these different things with you guys, because that's on you. What I do want to share is the universal. How you practice each one of these things is for you guys. How I practice it is probably very different than how you guys practice it. So make these yours. But these are the universals that I have seen get people through those obstacles. Faith. When you're sitting there on a wall, holding security, looking up, and you hear your teammates scream, you better reach into something bigger than you. Better reach into something bigger than you. The thing you don't know is we'd only been on the ground for 36 hours. We just got there. We just got there, and it was the start of an 8-month deployment. We were the first group to arrive. So we were actually getting ready to set up everything for the main team. Everyone else was still in the States. And we were already flying a guy back that was still unstable, and we didn't know if he was gonna live or die. Talk about morale. They're still home. And guys are already coming back. So the violence that was going to be seen on that deployment exposed itself right off the bat. And for those families, they're on leave. So to be home with their kids, with their wives, and the reality of what they're getting ready to get into, and to sit there and to be with their family and to kiss them for maybe the last time, to say that final goodbye, and to grab their stuff and walk out the door, walk on a plane, and fly into that area. All those people who had faith. Once again, I'm going to take this hall, and I want to take you guys. We're going to travel once again. We're going to leave Annapolis. We're going to leave Maryland. this time we're in stand six. But I'm going to rewind time. I'm going to rewind the time for all of us. Not to 2009, but to 2011. 2011. You're now on a plane. You're getting ready to board a plane. TV screens are on. You're actually getting ready to get on your connecting flight, and you happen to run into some other friends. And the news is talking about an accident overseas. Something that might have killed a lot of troops. And so as you run into your friends, you talk about it for a moment in time. You catch up with them. You're like, hey, you guys hear about that?
Yeah.
You know anything about it?
No.
You board the plane. We are now getting ready to land. We're landing in Norfolk. It's late in the evening. You're actually not even supposed to be on this plane. You were supposed to still be on your training trip, but the training trip ended a little early. You're like, hey, I'll jump on, get an early flight. I'm gonna go spend an extra night with my family, and I'll surprise them. So you get on this plane. You land in Norfolk. Norfolk's in Virginia. And as you land, what do you do? What does everyone do when we land? Power up our phone. So as we're taxiing down, you reach in your pocket, you pull out your phone, you turn it on. And like you expect it to, it buzzes. But then it buzzes again. And again, and again. And you're looking at the text messages and missed phone calls. It's in the tens, then it goes to the 20s, and then it goes to the 30s. But you've been doing this long enough, and you've been in this community long enough that you know what that means. You know somebody's probably dead, again. You can feel your body physically start locking up as you're looking at your phone. You're still on the plane. Plane's pulling in. They're all from your boss. So as you're sitting there on the plane, call your boss. Don't even say anything. He asks you one thing. He's like, he asks you if your roommate's wife, if she's at home. And you see what you've done is you've taken in another family into your home because they were building the house. They're starting a new family. They're building a brand new house. And to help them save money, you let them live with you. So you have his kids and his wife at your house. So you tell your boss, hey, I'm not sure. I just landed. I'll call home and I'll find out. So you call the house. And you find out that she just left. That she had left earlier that day because her parents just live in the DC area. So she was gonna go spend the weekend with them. So she's actually not there. So you call your boss back and you pass that information on to him. And you still haven't asked anything. And you can feel the knots in your body, the tension, your heart sink, your mouth almost go dry. You take a deep breath, and you muster up enough courage to ask him, is he dead? You know the answer. He says yes. You muster up enough courage again to ask him a second question. Who else? He says, I can't say right now. Clench your jaw. Is that okay? Still on this flight, people are now starting to move their luggage around. It starts offloading. There's some other SEALs sitting behind you that you happen to run into during this connecting flight. They're like, hey, what happened? I don't know. And I tell them, I know my roommate said, and then they start asking the other names that were on the same team as my roommate. Very good friends of theirs. I don't know. Go home, change, grab some stuff, going to work. We're now at work. We're talking to our boss. He gives us a list of names of guys who have been killed. And you look at that list and you think to yourself, just one of those names would have been a tragedy. You now go into this catatonic state where it seems like things are moving around you and you're not even aware of it. You're just going through motions. Somehow you manage to help out with things. And you know you're going to be on the notification team. So you pull out your blues. Because in this line of work, you know that you should always have your blues ready for things like this. Fast forward. You're now stepping out of the car. Now with a team of other men, all in blues, the sun is now up. You're in DC, and you're starting to walk to the front door of this house. And you think to yourself, this can't be real. And you're still in this catatonic state, this state of shock. You're like, no, this isn't real. This has got to be something. I'm playing a scene in a movie. This is the only time I've seen this. I'm an actor. Like, this isn't mine. I don't belong in this. I don't belong in this scene. The reality of it hits you. As that knock goes on the door, and it's early in the morning, the front door opens up, and her dad answers the door. Her dad just looks at the group of us standing there. See, her dad is a retired Navy captain. And he knows what that means. As you stand there, looking at him, the realization hits him as he sees you in that group. He looks at you and says one word. daughter now comes around the corner, holding her 8-week-old. Hey, Dad, who's at the door? Once again, she pauses, takes in the scene. She sees you, and the realization hits her. She almost drops her baby. She manages to hang on to her as she crumbles to the floor. Sometimes you need to survive the obstacle. And to survive the obstacle, you need a strong foundation. So these four F's that I'm sharing with you guys this morning are things that, once again, I've used and I've seen others use to survive the obstacle. That first one was faith. This one's friends and family. When an obstacle like that hits you, and you see it physically hit somebody and crumble them to the floor, you better have faith. You better have family. You better have friends to help you get through. I know people have different relationships with their family. What I like to share with very close friends of mine, because I'm not as close to some of my family as I probably should be. But I have some friends that I consider family. And I tell them, we don't have to share the same blood to be family. Because they've been there for me, and I've been there for them when the reality of life hits. Travel one last time. I want to take you guys on one more trip. Once again, we're going to turn this hall into our time machine. We're going to leave Annapolis. We're going to leave Maryland. But once again, we're going to stay in the States. I'm going to rewind the clock to 2014. Rewound it, 2009, 2011, 2014. So just 4 years ago. We're not in Afghanistan. We're not on a plane. This time it's early evening. We're in a major city. You're just now stepping out of a hotel. You're with a group of friends. You're walking down the street. You and your group decided that you're gonna go to this dinner place about 5 blocks from the hotel. You're having a great trip. Make it to the restaurant. Get inside. Waiting to be seated, your phone vibrates. You reach into your pocket, pull your phone out, you look, and you see who's calling. It's a good friend of yours, but it's a good friend of yours who doesn't call very often. So you decide to answer it. barely get out a hello. And your friend begins to tell you that he thinks your best friend was just killed. You look at your phone, automatically pissed off. You get back on it. Did you just call me and tell me you think he just got killed? No, it didn't. Don't ever call anyone and say that. And then you hang up on them. Put your phone back in your pocket. At this time, the group's been seated. So you move to the table, you sit down, and you tell yourself, let it go. He was mistaken. Didn't happen. Just enjoy your dinner. The rest of the table, laughing, looking over the menu, talking about the trip, catching up. And you're trying to push this to the side of your mind, but you can't. You're not able to join the conversation. You just sit there and you just think of that. Your phone buzzes again. Once again, you reach in your pocket, pull your phone out, and you look down at it. And this time you see that it's your best friend's dad calling you. Body tightens up, stomach drops, throat tightens, jaw clenches. Step up, walk away from the table. And you already know what this means. You answer the call. You answer your phone to a grown man crying. Try and hold it together for him. And you listen to him. And you listen to him tell you how his son was killed in a training accident. You tell him you love him. And you tell him you'll be there as soon as you can. You hang up, go back to the table, your boss is sitting there, you tell him, man, I'm going to catch the next flight out of here, explain to him what happened, and then you tell him that you're not sure when you'll be back with the group, but you'll be out there with the family. And he just looks at you and he says, yep, whatever you need. You leave the restaurant, walking down the street, back to your hotel. And once again, you feel yourself go in that catatonic state. As things are moving around you, and the reality of it all doesn't seem real. But that weight starts stacking on your shoulders, and you're just trying to hold it together. And not break down on the side of the street. You make it back to the hotel. Close your door. At that point, Sometimes you just need to survive the obstacle. Because the reality of life is hard. And to survive that obstacle, you need a strong foundation. Mention faith, mention family, mention your friends. And the last point I want to touch on is your focus. I love this conference. I think it's awesome that I get to be a part of an institution that has a leadership conference like this. And I love the theme of this conference. Obstacles are opportunities. And we can sit here in this hall and talk about the speakers that we've heard and that we're going to hear, and sit here and be like, yeah, obstacles are opportunities. Like, yeah, we got this. This is great. So we're sitting in our climate control environment in this beautiful building in Annapolis, Maryland. We're like, yeah, we can do this. It's easy to do here. It's real easy here. As you guys leave this conference, you go back to reality, you go back to your lives, that weight of life starts getting stacked on. And I like to call it the storm. Just like imagery that I can use that works for me. Sometimes you can see those storms coming. Sometimes you get a warning. And sometimes you walk outside and you're unprepared for it, and that storm hits you. And it challenges your foundation for what you're built on. And there's storms that hit that you barely notice. And there's some storms that hit, and I've seen people never come back from it. Obstacles are opportunities. It's cute. It's cute for us to say that. Yeah. How do you get to that point? To where you can look at the things that life throws at us, these storms that come in and out of our lives, and actually say that during that time. When the weight of reality is on your shoulders, and you're feeling that weight, and you're feeling your knees start to buckle, or that blow is taking you to the ground, and you're the one crumbled on the floor, how can you say that? Obstacles are opportunities. Focus. It's your mindset. Like anything else, when you get better at something, you have to practice. It's a 3-day leadership conference. If this was a sports clinic, and I had you guys for 3 days, 3 days would maybe not even be enough time to cover the fundamentals. Leadership is so broad, and there's so much to it, that even in this conference, just scratching the surface, how do you become a better leader? So this mindset of obstacles or opportunities, you have to focus on that, and you have to practice that. How good are you at something if you just do it 3 days out of the year in the sports arena? Probably not very good. I know there's there's a lot of athletes sitting out here. Think about how often you train. Focus. Start out with the small things. Once again, just like sports, if you're new to a sport, what do you start out with? The fundamentals, the basics. To have this mindset of opportunities, obstacles or opportunities, those small things that happen to you throughout the day, that's what you have to start using. Those are your opportunities. Those small obstacles, those are your opportunities. And that's when you start to practice. So as that obstacle comes into your life, there's my opportunity to practice. What a great opportunity for me to practice this. You start out with those small things, and then you move through the day. And each day you practice that. You have to make a choice to practice that. And that choice then becomes what? A habit. And that habit becomes what? Part of your character. Part of your character. And I know you guys have talked about character over these past few days. I argue that character, that's the foundation. That's the foundation that leadership is built on top of. Who you are, your character, especially when that storm comes in and hits you, you will be tested. And it's not just for you to survive. Those stories that I shared with you, none of that wasn't my time. None of those things were for me. It was so I could be strong enough, so now my foundation could be strong enough, so I could help somebody else. That's where we should be. It's to where you build your foundation, and it is so strong that as a storm hits in somebody else's life, that you're actually able to provide shelter for them. You're able to support them. Those stories that I shared, I was fortunate to have very strong mentors in my life. And I have faith. And I have friends, I have family. And this is something that I've practiced for a long time. So I was able to continue that mission. I was able to support the families, to support the new widow. I was able to go support my best friend's family as their storm hit them and took them crumbling to the ground. Repetition is the father of learning. And if you want a mindset to where that storm hits, and you're able to brace up against it, and weather it, and take in others, and help them out, not just at work. Big events happen, like what the Commandant was talking about earlier. But in your own life, in your friends' life, your families, because that's who you are, that's your character. So I challenge you. I challenge you today. as you guys leave today, and as you leave this conference, that you just don't write down and have a bunch of notes that you leave here with, and it goes into some shelf that you never touch again. Like, I challenge you to do this. I challenge you to look at all these notes that you guys have taken over these past few days, and to practice, and to look at those, and say, hey, this is what I'm gonna do. And you make it your focus. Obstacles are opportunities. I challenge you, when an obstacle hits you, that you say that to yourself. Oh, this is an opportunity. That's my challenge to you today. Have a strong foundation, faith, family, friends, and focus. All right, thank you.
First, we'd like to present you with a small token of our appreciation, Chief. Thank you. Our next panel, everyone, will begin in 10 minutes. If you guys would like to sit, reflect, there's coffee up front as well. Take this time. Thank you.